This is the story of the Rose of Tralee, Mary O'Connor. She lived in the middle of Tralee town in Brogue Lane, which took its name from the brogue makers or shoemakers who lived and worked there. Mary lived in a thatched cabin with her parents, sisters, Bridget and Ellen, and her younger brother, Willie. Her father was a shoemaker, and her mother was a dairymaid. Mary was very beautiful. She had long dark hair and soft shining eyes. Her status as the daughter of a shoemaker and dairymaid meant Mary was destined for work as a maid or house help. When she was 17, she secured employment as a kitchen maid for the Multnock household in Tralee. The Multnocks were a wealthy family of merchants who owned a wool and linen draper shop on the site of what is now Heaton's department store in Tralee. The Multnocks family owned a considerable amount of land around the house and neighbourhood, as well as property in town. They had servants, coachmen, gardeners and farmhands. Mr. Multnock died of a fever in 1828, so Margaret Multnock was head of the household when Mary started working in the kitchens of West Villa. Also living in the house were Margaret's sons, William, Edward, Henry, and her married daughter Maria. Mary was delighted to be given employment. Margaret's daughter Maria saw how kind Mary was to her two children, so she became her nursemaid to her two daughters. In November 1840, Henry, William's younger brother, died. William was inconsolable, as he was closer to Henry than his more practical brother, Edward. He wrote a poem about his feelings.
For him was the fair young bride weep, who takes in the churchyard, now he sleep. For he was the star above some bright, that tinged with light of love by night.
It wasn't long before William met his sister's new nursemaid. As soon as he saw Mary, he was transfixed by her eyes, her grace, her long dark hair and delicate skin. Mary and William began to meet each other by the well in the grounds of West Villa that looked over the sea and mountains. Sometimes they walked down Lover's Lane or up to Glahan to dance. One night, beneath the pale silvery moon, William asked Mary to marry him. However, William's family disapproved of him seeing Mary, the shoemaker's daughter who lived in a small, pleasant house in the middle of town. Whilst Mary loved William, she knew that their union could never be, as it would force him to turn his back on his family and would begin to regret the day he had ever met her. She declined his offer of marriage. William refused to give up. He wrote a song for Mary to try and convince her otherwise, but Mary still refused to marry him. The next evening, after attending a political rally in town, William went to visit Mary and gave her a ring which he placed on her finger. Suddenly, a friend of William's rushed in to inform him that he had been accused of murder of a man at the rally. Two men got into a fight, and as leader of one of the rebel groups challenging the upcoming election, William had been held responsible. William's friend informed him there was a warrant out for his arrest and a reward of 100 gold sovereigns for finding him. He was told to make for Barrow Harbour and get on a wine ship that was leaving that night. William embraced Mary, said goodbye, and told her he would return soon. William went to India, where he worked as a war correspondent. So, in 1849, some 6 years after leaving Tralee, William returned. He stopped off at the King's Arms in Rock Street for a drink before planning to visit Mary in the nearby Brogue Lane. The landlord began to draw the curtains to mark the passing of a funeral coming down the street. On inquiring who the funeral was for, William was told it was for a local girl from Brogue Lane, a lovely and fair young girl named Mary O'Connor, the Rose of Tralee.